Good morning, student. So we discuss about the polarizations. Today we start a specific topic of polarization, that is the specific rotations. So now, what exactly specific rotations? So we are familiar with the polarizations. Everybody are the familiar with the polarizations. So what is the polarization? So it's a very simple thing that if unpolarized light is passing through any polarizer, it will be converted into a polarized light. So this is a polarized light. It's passing through a polarizer. It will be converted into polarized light. So this is the polarized light. So the quality of the polarized light is that all the vibrations are lying in the same place. Okay. Now, but the question is, if we introduce a one material, like if we introduce any material which has a specific quality, and the quality is that this material can be able to rotate this polarized light. That means if this polarized light is incident on this material, let's this is the glass tube, it's filled by this material, then this material can be able to rotate the polarized light. Now this is the ideal path. If we do not introduce this material in the part of polarized light, but if we introduce this material, it will be change the path of this polarized light. So now the new path may be this one or this one. So let some angle is introducing here. This angle is introducing here. So if we do not use this material, we can easily detect this polarized light by using any analyzers. So if we have analyzers, we can easily detect this polarized light. But now we introduce this material here. Due to this material, the path of the polarized light will change, and the new path is this one. So now for detecting this new polarized light, we have to be change the orientations of these analyzers. So maybe the new orientations in this one. So this angle, which is the same, this angle is known as the specific rotations. So how we can define the specific rotations? We can define the specific rotation in such a manner that it is the angle created by the analyzer. Angle created by analyzer for detecting thing of polarized light, for the detecting of the polarized light which change its path due to some specific rotating material. Now these materials may be sugar solutions or some glass or some other viscous materials. Now this specific rotation will be depend on the some factors, and now this factor may be this will be depend on some factors and the factors are this specific rotations. Rotations depend on some factors, and the factors are this will be depend on depend on the length of polarimeter tube. One part is this will be depend on the length of the polarimeter tube. Basically, polarimeter tube is nothing but it's a device where we introduce this material. And one more thing is that this specific rotation will be depend on the thickness of the substance. We using the substance in this polarimeter tube, so this will be depend on the substance used in the polarimeter tube. This will be depend on the thickness of the substance in the polarimeter tube. This will be also depend on the wavelength of the light. This will be also depend on the wavelength of the light, polarized light. It will depend on the wavelength of light. What is the wavelength of the light? We know that we have a different wavelength of light. One more point, this will be also depend on the temperatures of this substance. So will be depend on the temperature of this substance. Right? So this 4 point on which this specific rotation will be depend. One is the length of the polarimeter tube. Second, depend on the substance. This will be depend on the wavelength of the light, and this will be depend on the temperature of the substance. Now we derive the formula for this specific rotations. Then we will be given generalized formalism of this specific rotations. So let's we consider a small amount of crystalline material. We consider a crystalline material which introduce a rotation in this polarized light. So if we have a crystalline material, for any crystalline material, specific rotations angle theta, specific angle rotation theta will be equals to alpha L, will be equals to alpha I, where theta is specific rotations angle of specific rotations, L is the length of this polarimeter tube, alpha is constant, which is vary from different crystalline material. So theta is equals to alpha L. This is for the crystalline material. Now we introduce some solutions. If we have some solutions, what will be the formalisms? We know for any solutions we consider some quantities like volume, the mass and concentrations. What is the concentrations of these solutions? So if we have a concentration C, C is the concentrations of solutions, then specific rotations will be theta is equals to S. I am right now defined specific rotation by symbol S, and S will be specific rotations, S will be equals to theta upon L multiply C. Theta is rotation angle created by the substance, and L is the length of this polarimeter tube, and C is the concentrations. Then the specific rotations will be theta by L C. Theta, the unit of this theta is degree. Unit of theta is degree. Length is in decimeter. Decimeter. And C, gram per cc cube. Gram per cc cube. This will be the unit of this specific rotations. Right. So we derive the formula, that is specific rotation S equals to theta upon L C. So now we give a generalized definition of this formalism. Lest the angle we define all these parameters in a unit quantity, that if length is 1, C is 1, what will be the specific rotations? So if all quantities are unit, then we can say the specific rotations for a given wavelength of a light, the wavelength is fixed for a given wavelength of a light at a given temperature. Temperature is also constant. Wavelength and temperature are constant. So for a given wavelength and a given temperature, it is defined that it's conventionally the rotation produced by 1 decimeter long column. It's the angle which is produced by the 1 decimeter long column of the solution which concentration is 1 gram of optically active material per cc of solutions. Means the concentration is 1 gram per cc and length is 1 decimeter, then the angle created by this material will be equal to the specific rotations. Right? Next, how we can measure this specific rotation? The question is, how we can measure it? We define this specific rotations, and now our aim is to find out this specific rotations by experimental technique. So we can find out the specific rotations of any substance by using polarimeters. We have one polarimeter which name is Lorentz half set polarimeters. So we have polarimeter, that is Lorentz half set polarimeter. So the first we define the definition of polarimeter. So the polarimeter is, it is a device, it is a device which is used for the calculations of calculations of for the calculations or determinations of specific rotations of polarized light. Right? So this is used to find out the specific rotations angles of a polarized light which is created by the substance which we introduce between polarizers and analyzers. Right. So this is the Lorentz object polarimeter. So very first I draw the working diagram of this polarimeter tubes. Later we will be discuss about the half set polarimeters. So how this Lorentz half set polarimeter working for the determinations of this specific rotations. So let's I draw the diagram. Very first, this is unpolarized light source. This is unpolarized light source. S. I am defining here unpolarized light source. Right? Now we use a convex lens in the path of the light which is produced by this unpolarized light, this convex lens. Why we use this convex lens? This convex lens will be collimated this beam into a single path. This will be collimated this beam. So this unpolarized light incident on this lens L. L is the convex lens. Now this unpolarized light incident on polarizers, on a one polarizer, this light is incident on a polarizer. Polarizers, I am defined it by N1. So N1 is polarizer. So this unpolarized light is incident on this polarizer N1. Now tell me what happened. If this unpolarized light will be incident on the polarizers, then it will be divided into the two parts. One is the E ray, another is the O ray. Or we can say the outcome will be the completely polarized light. So the outcome is polarized light. So I am defining the polarized light by this arrow, parallel arrow. Right. Now we introduce half set polarimeter between this path. We introduce half set polarimeter here. Before this, let's introduce We introduce the substance which is created a angle between this initial positions and a new position. So this is the substance. And the final outcome will be not a polarized light in this path. This is not a polarized light. So I am denoting by a tilted line. And here I am introducing half set polarimeter. Half set polarimeter. This is HSP, half set polarimeter. So the path is changed by the substance will be compensated by this offset polar emitter, or this will be observed by this offset polar emitter. And we have finally one more analyzer here, which is N2 is analyzer. Analyzer and finally telescope, microscope, right? So this is our polarizer, this is our analyzer, and this is a glass tube. In this glass tube, we introduce the substance which create a specific rotation in this polarized light, and this polarized light will be passing through this half-side polarimeter, and finally it will be observed by this analyzers. So we can calculate the specific rotation angle by using this device or this half-side polarimeter, half-side polarimeter device. So now, what is the working of this half-side polarimeter? So now I draw one more diagram. So basically, half-side polarimeter in half-side polarimeter, the joint quartz and glass plate, this portion is the quartz, one side is the quartz, and this is a glass material. The joint quartz and this glass in such a manner that the light can be transmitted through quartz as well as the glass. So basically we are maintain the thickness of the quartz as well as the lens. So let's, this is the A, this is the point B, and this is point C, and this point is D, and this is the angle theta, right? So one part is the quartz and another part is the glass of this half-side polarimeter tube. Now the condition is, I'm writing number first, one part half-side polarimeter is quartz, while other part is glass. Second point, the thickness of the quartz and the glass plate is maintained in such a manner, the thickness of quartz as well as glass maintain in such a manner that light can easily transmit through it, right? It can be easily transmit through it. Now the optical axis, this optical axis is parallel to this AC. The optical axis is parallel to AC. This AC, this optical axis is parallel to AC. These are the three points which we maintain in the half-side polarimeter. So whatever the light which is rotated by this substance is observed by this half-side polarimeter. So this is a device which is used for measuring a specific rotations. What is clear? So now we solve some numerical problem based on the polarizations as well as the specific rotations. So the first problem is, if the plane of vibrations of incident beam make an angle of 30 degree with the optical axis, compare the intensity of extraordinary and ordinary light. So we have to compare the intensity of extraordinary as well as the ordinary light if the created angle is 30 degree. So angle theta is 30 degree. Question number 1. Now tell me the formula of intensity of E ray, that means extraordinary ray, and O ray means ordinary ray. So we know that the intensity of extraordinary is how much? Yes, tell me, the intensity of extraordinary is E square cos square theta. E square, good, E square cos square theta. And the intensity of ordinary light is E square sin square theta. We have two intensity, extraordinary and ordinary, and we have the angle theta is 30 degree. So what will be the ratio? We are finding the ratio of the intensity of IE and OE. Yes, so then extraordinary intensity will be E square cos square 30 degree, and extraordinary is E square sin square 30 degree. E square sin square 30 degree. So this will be E square. The value of cos square 30 is root 3 by 2 and root 3 by 2 whole square. This is E square 3 by 2, and this will be E square under root 2 square. This is E square 1 by 2. So if we write the ratio, that is IE upon IO is equals to 3. That means the intensity of extraordinary is 3 times of the intensity of ordinary light. Clear? Okay. Next question. Next is, calculate the thickness of double reflection plate capable of producing a path difference. The path difference is lambda, is path difference del, path difference del is lambda by 4 between extraordinary and ordinary waves. We have the two waves. One is the extraordinary and another is the ordinary, and given lambda is 5890 angstrom. So basically we have to find out the thickness. What is D? So lambda is given and we need to find out the value of D. How we can find it? We know the formula that for the double refractions, that D is equals to lambda by 4 mu E minus mu O, mu E minus mu O. Yes, tell me, what will be the value of mu E and the value of mu O? Mu E is the refractive index of extraordinary, extraordinary refractive index, and mu O is ordinary ray refractive index, and this is 1.54 and this is 1.53. This is 1.54 and this is 1.53. So if you have the value mu E and mu O, and you also know the value of lambda, then substitute this value in this expression. So this will be 5890 angstrom. I'm writing into 10 to the power minus 10 meter. 4 mu is 1.54 and minus 1.53. So we just substitute all these value in meter, and if we calculate, we will observe, find the value 4.7 micrometer. So this is the thickness of refracting plates. We calculate the thickness of the reflection plates. Right. So now the last numerical is based on the specific rotations. It's 200 millimeter long tube containing 48 centimeter cube of sugar solutions produce an optical rotations of 11 degree when placed in a square meter. If the specific rotations of sugar solution is 66 degree, calculate the quantity of the sugar containing in the tube in the form of solutions. What are given? We know the value length of this polarimeter tube, we know the value of specific rotations, we also know the value of the concentrations, and it's contain 48 centimeter cube of sugar solutions, right? So volume is 48 centimeter cube and air is 200 millimeter. So let's, theta is 11 degree, air is 200 millimeter, and volume is 48 centimeter cube. So yes, specific rotations, S is equals to 66 degree. Calculate the quantity. Quantity means, what is M? What will be the M? So how we can calculate it, the M? We know the relations between the concentration and M is C equals to M by V. So if we know the value of C, then M will be C multiplied V. So very first we calculate the value of C, then finally substitute this value in this formula and we'll calculate the value of M. So now I'm writing the formula, and the formula of the C will be tan theta upon, yes, what will be the value? Tan theta upon L by, yes, L by specific rotations, this specific rotations L S. So now put the value 10 multiplied theta, theta is 11, length is 200 multiplied 66. Calculate this value, 10 multiplied by 11 divided by 200 millimeters. millimeters. Yes. So if we write in SI system, this will be 10 multiplied 11 upon 20 multiplied 66. 20 multiplied 66. So if we calculate this value, the value will be 0.0838. This will be 0.0838 gram per cc cube, gram per cc, centimeter cube, cm cube. Okay, so this is the concentrations. So now multiply this concentration by volume. So 0.m is, I'm writing here, m is 0.0838 multiplying the volume 48. So and the unit will be unit is gram per centimeter cube multiply centimeter cube. This will be cancel out. So now multiply 0.0838 with the volume 48, then we will have the value 4 gram. This is the quantity of a 4 gram. So if you know the value of the specific rotations, theta, L and all these, then you can calculate concentrations, and by using these concentrations you can calculate the substance, weight of the substance, mass, which is 4 gram. So today I stop this polarizations and specific rotations. So in the next class we will start the diffractions. Thank you.